today we have a special opportunity. One of our dear friends from around the globe, Lana Vasquez, she moved to Thailand around 13, 14 years ago from LA. She's a Cali girl and moved to Thailand. I've been over there, had the privilege to be in part of her ministry and what she's doing there. We're, again, sending a team in February. And Lana's going to come and share with us a little bit about her ministry and what they're doing. But I'm going to show you two videos first to get you a little bit of a picture what you're doing. Some of you know and some of you may not, that we give a tithe, 10% of all the income that comes in from our offering, we give 10% of that out every month into other ministries. And Lana is one of those ministries that we support every month by giving a percentage out of whatever we take in. And through that, we've been able to rescue children. We've been able to help being part of building homes. All of that you're doing. Whenever you give into that, whether you're texting in your amount or giving online or just writing out a check, you are helping save people even in Thailand, Burma, Southeast Asia, all the things that you're going to see in just a moment. So I want to say, Dawn and I want to say thank you for helping us from North City impact all around the world through your giving. It's an honor to be a part of that with you. So check out this video to see what's happening in Life Impact International and the part you're playing in it.
They get one scoop of rice, they work, they go from 9 o'clock at night to 3 in the morning. It's just slave labor. They have to go barefoot, they have to beg, they have to be around the brothels, they're around all of the prostitution. And there's a lot of pedophiles that come to Bangkok, so there's a lot of demand for them. It's a very dangerous place once they get here and once they get in that underworld.
This is Kilo 20. This is a project that we started because it's a very at-risk area, completely unreached. Never heard the gospel. A lot of animists in this. They worship the trees. They worship the spirits. And so he is breaking ground here. One of the major things that they've started to reach the children of this community is a school. These kids have to work in the fields. They're 10 years old, 11 years old, 12 years old, sent in the fields to labor. If they don't work, they don't eat. They live hand to mouth. They have to go and pick the food for that night. So if we get a school and we feed them, we were able to teach them, it'll change their life, it'll change their future. So that's what we did. We said, get all the kids. We don't want to see any 12-year-olds, any 10-year-olds working in the fields. Want them to come. Pastor Salai and his wife and a soon-to-be new baby, they're the ones that started the school. We have 30 children here that are prevented. This is our prevention project. It prevents children from being sold and trafficked. A lot of children here will go into the slave trade and will go into the brothels down in Bangkok, get trafficked. Unless we intervene and unless we provide solutions for the families as a whole, keep these children and their families together, but provide creative ways for them to support their family, for them to not have to sell their children, provide creative ways for them to just see that their children are valuable and they're not commodities to be sold, or they're not a burden that they just another mouth to feed, but yet they're their future, they're the hope for their family, they're the next generation, these children that would never ever know a chalkboard, know a pencil, know a piece of paper. If anything, they were destined to be laborers, they were destined to be child slaves, or destined to eventually be trafficked or sold down to Bangkok. These children are now getting an education. They're prevented from being sold, and their life story has changed forever. He was a beggar. He had to make 70 baht a day. If not, they'd beat him. 4 years old, so cute, super cute. His mom had sold him to the Mamasan, or Mamasans are the owners of the street beggar ring or the street beggar children. And the mom had sold him for $30. And she's actually a prostitute in Bangkok. And so we are trying to get him, trying to negotiate with him, met with the Mamasan twice. She wouldn't give him up. He was her bread and butter. He was one of the favorites on the street, because one of the most earners, because he is so cute. So finally, after lots of negotiation, they kept him from the streets for about a month because they were scared we were going to get them. And just by chance, one day we were here with the team. We were walking up and down, prayer walking, and he was there with all the children, and we were able to snatch him and to get him that day and to rescue him. And we got him miraculously. So right after this little boy, we got another girl and her baby brother. 7-year-old girl with 1-year-old baby brother. I mean, just the baby brother was about to die. He looked just so disfigured. His skin was falling off his bones. He couldn't walk. And the mom, again, she had left down to Bangkok to be a prostitute, and she had left a $100 debt to these kids to pay off. So they had to beg every day. The 7-year-old sister with the 1-year-old brother on her hip had to beg every day to try to pay off the mom's $100 debt to get down to Bangkok. The baby was gonna die. I mean, if we didn't interact, if we didn't get them, then definitely that baby was gonna die. And you should see them now. Within 3 months, they look like completely different children. They filled up. I mean, just all of it. They look like completely different children. We know that their life was forever changed. And that's part of it to the scripture that the Lord had given us about these street children and what we could do right here in no man's land with all of these children that are sold. He just said, I'll give you the precious treasures in darkness. And we just know that these street kids, they're the precious treasures sitting in darkness, waiting for us to come and get them, waiting for us to come and pick them up, to wash the dirt off them, to clean them up, and give them a hope and a future in Jesus Christ. I think this is the most special outreach that they have, especially to my heart, because this is the promise that the Lord gave me over 13 years ago, probably about 15 years ago, when he said, you will reach more through the children than you'll ever reach alone. And he gave me Psalm 127:3, as arrows in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. They will not be ashamed, but they will subdue, conquer the enemy at the gate. And the neat thing is this place is called Gate 2, which means it's a gate from Burma to Thailand. So most trafficking's done here. It's just another hub of illegal things coming over and just human trafficking. And so I didn't even know the fullness of the promise, but right now, behind my shoulder, this is the fullness of the promise of God that he told me. And he also said that when you change a generation, that generation will change their nation. And so it's neat to see this generation of rescued girls, healed children, them changing this nation, Thailand, but also the nation right over that river where there's a huge temple on that side, the nation of Burma. And so it's not just one nation, but they're changing nations from this one spot right here. So I guess this, to me, is just such, this is the emphasis of what we're all about, and this encompasses everything right here.
Chimwa.
Chimwa.
Sata Bai.
Sata Bai.
Ame.
Ame.
Abi. Abi. Abi.
House of Hope was started as a home for street kids. We started rescuing kids on the Thai side of the border, but some of them were still on the Burma side, and we knew we couldn't get them over to the Thai side or it would be like trafficking. So we said we have to do something on the Burma side. Around that time I was looking over, and Myanmar was closed. We couldn't really get in and we couldn't do anything. But I was praying, I was walking up and down our border and around the Friendship Bridge, and I was praying, and the Lord gave me the scripture, and he said, I will open the double doors before you, and I will give you treasures in darkness. And I knew that those treasures in darkness were the street kids and the begging kids and the kids that had just been thrown away and the laboring kids, the slave labor kids. And so from that, around that time, God opened the door and we started rescuing the street kids on the Burma side. We opened up a feeding center and we started feeding them. And then we started negotiating with their parents and the different owners to let them go to school. Seventeen street children used to be on the streets, barefoot, begging. They'd have to make about 70 baht a day, which is $2.10. If they wouldn't bring that home, they'd get beaten. Before you would ask them, what do they want to be when they grow up? And none of them would know. And they never had that chance to even dream or think about what they want to be. Now they have a future full of hope, just full of expectation. They're getting an education and they're not destined to be beggars, trafficked, just street children. That's why we named this home House of Hope. House of Hope for these street children. House of Hope for their future. House of Hope for their lives.
Like Pastor Chad was saying, you guys are a part of that. You know, this church was actually one of the biggest donors this year for the ministry. And those faces that you see, you were a part of rescuing, literally rescuing, not just in salvation for eternity, but their physical bodies, their physical lives. We now have 120 rescued children in 4 different homes in 2 countries. And it's just been incredible what the Lord has done. You know, in that one with the little boy with the dimples, the really cute one, I need to tell you guys something. The Lord, the last time when I was here, he was speaking to me about just Isaiah, and he gave me a particular scripture that I'm going to share with you. But it was really neat because we had been negotiating for him. We've been trying to rescue that boy, and he actually, the mafia had taken him off the streets because they knew we were after him. So they were scared we were going to get him. And we had already done multiple rescues of that other the brother and sister that you saw in another one. So they took him off the street, scared of us. And then there was one time we were there, and actually the girl that was believing to go on a rescue. Hannah, where did you raise your hand? She actually had come up to Thailand and was believing to rescue a child with us. She was in our vehicle. We went, we saw the boy there, and actually there was a ring, the whole ring, and they had told the older kids to protect that little boy and to not take him. So when we came up, there was an older grandma and the rest of the ring, and they locked arms with this boy, right? They locked arms, and so that they said, you're not getting him. And so we all locked arms there at that moment. And then the Lord just really gave, it was crazy. Spirit of the Lord came on me, just God's presence. And he said, go over to those soldiers and go and bring them with you. And just so, I think it was Hannah or somebody, I said, stay right here. Don't let him go anywhere. If the grandma tries to attack you, just hold on to her arm. I know it's not right and culturally polite at all, but we can't let this boy go. She doesn't care about him. You know, she's going to sell him. So just hold on to him. So I walked over to where the soldiers were and I said, you guys, come with me. And they all looked up with their guns and they said, okay. And they just got up, four of them, and followed me. They didn't know where, and they're talking to each other like, where are we going? I could hear them in Thai, where are we going? They're like, I don't know, just go with her. She said, come with me. And so we went over there, and literally, so the grandma saw these soldiers coming, and it was right on the border, so they're illegal, so they're scared, and they're involved in trafficking and drug trafficking. So they were scared that the police were coming for them, so the grandma let go of the little boy's arm. And then so we grabbed him, we threw him in the van, and we rescued him, and nobody knew what happened. And even the soldiers are just like, okay, go ahead, take him. I don't know what's going on. And they're just looking at each other, confounded. But it was just so neat how the Spirit of the Lord had come on us and how it all worked out and how it was all went down. And little did you know, then we had the little boy in our van and looking at him. He's looking at us. We're looking at him. And it was incredible just how the Lord just worked that all out. I wanted to read to you this scripture. And it has to do with that. And it says, Isaiah 45, thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. That word held mean whose right hand I have strengthened and sustained, to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut. I will go before you and I will make the crooked places straight. That translation says, I will level mountains. I will trample down walls. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places. And for me, the Lord was speaking to me about the children of the border and the children that are in the slave trade and the children that are sold and the children that are already in the mafia's care. And it says, and hidden riches of secret places that you may know that I, the Lord, who call you by your name, am the God of Israel. For Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, my elect, I have even called you by your name. I have named you, though you have not known me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun, that they may know from the rising of the sun, that they may know from the rising of the sun to its setting, that there is none besides me. So God, I was, we're on that border, and we're walking up and down, and we were taking, I think I was bringing a team where we were prayer walking or something, and we zoomed in, and across that water, that river, I saw a little kid's brothel, a little girl's brothel, and I saw girls 10 to 12 years old. And the reason why I knew it was what it was is I saw little girls with their hair wet, and they were in like three chairs, and I saw two boys with the muscle man tank tops on, about 19, 20 years old. One was guarding the doorway, and one was brushing a little girl's hair. And I knew that that was a little girl's brothel. And I remember my heart just breaking and saying, there's nothing I can do. You know, there's soldiers right here. There's soldiers right here. They're all in on it. The government's in on it. The police own all the brothels on our border. I can't just put a child on my hip and run over the side. There's nothing I could do. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, stop saying that. There's always something you can do. And so he said that, and he quickened, and he gave me this scripture. And I'm telling you, from that, he opened the door with the government. And so we have a street kids home. Like you said, we have the first ever street kids home right there on the border where the government has come, and also teachers and a prominent doctor in the area, and they have come and they've invited us to go to their house, and they put out a big spread for my staff, and they said, we have never seen children go from beggars, from thieves, to being front row in class and raising their hands. What you're doing is incredible. We've never ever seen this before in our country. And so God just turning around, giving us these kids, giving us these treasures in darkness. You know, so many times people say, how can you do that? Aren't you afraid? Aren't you, you know, I'm obviously like not even 5 foot. You know, they had to bring me out a new pulpit because you couldn't see me over the side. So now you can see me. And so, but they said, aren't you afraid? And I say, I've never once been afraid, never once. And you know why? I'm more afraid that when I'm on the elephant, you know, and it's going down, I feel like I'm going to flip. Like when I'm doing it, something fun, I'm more afraid of that. Or it's just a different silly things. I've never once been afraid in what I do because of this scripture. I know Jesus is holding my right hand and he's strengthening me and he's sustaining me. I know no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I know this. I know this, that I know this. I know the gates of hell will not prevail against the church, but there is a consciousness that Jesus is with me holding my hand. And if you don't get anything from this or all of this going on, I want you to get, let your heart be enlarged to what God wants to use you to do. He's going to ask you to do things that are out of your comfort zone, that he wants you just to enlarge your territory, enlarge just your tent. He wants to get you to step out of you, to get you to get the limits off, to get out of fear, because fear will limit you and hold you back. And the only way that you will do that is if you know that Jesus is holding your right hand, that he is strengthening you and he will sustain you. And that right hand has such significance. That right hand, whenever you see in the Bible, when it talks about right hand, it talks about the person of Jesus. When a person shakes your hand and it's a right hand to right hand, it signifies all that that person is and all that that person has, that person's word, that person's honor. Everything is on the line with a handshake like that. And the same with Jesus. When he says, I uphold you with my right hand and your right hand, all that he is backing you up and upholding you. And he's given you all that, all he is, all, everything that's embraced in his name, it's to you. And that's how you will be strengthened, and that's how you will be sustained to do whatever he has asked you or called you to do. Amen. I love this where it says, I will trample down walls for you. I will level mountains. Whatever stopping you or is standing in the middle from what Jesus has told you to do, if it's governments, whatever it is, he says, he'll loose the armor of kings and he'll open double doors, doors that you could have never thought possible. He'll open those doors of impossibility to get you to what's on the other side and what he told you. Amen. I don't know why, but I wanted to just stop there and say that to you, and that he will go before you and he'll make crooked ways straight. But anyways, whoever that was for. But I want you to know just what you're a part of and what he's doing. So that's going on. But then also some really huge things have gone on. If you could put up the PowerPoint. Recently, when I was in Brazil, the Lord's opened the doors of Brazil. And so we're going to be doing works there. But in between this time, what happened was I was in Brazil and they said, the pastors all come up and they said, Lana, the government. And then they said, government. Governments will come to you and ask you to help with the children of their nations. Governments will come to you and ask you what to do with the children of their nation. And they said that I get back to Thailand, and I was there 2 months passed by, and the governor came to our office in a secret meeting, and he said, all the government safe homes are full. We have 500 kids in each home, and they're overflowing, and we can't take any more, and we don't know what to do with these children. There's too much. They're coming over from Burma. So we just have to either drop them back off to Burma, or we can't. We just turn them away. He said, they are full. We need you. Will Life Impact become a government recognized, the first government recognized safe home on the border where we will you be the one that we can send all of these children to? There are 60 children trafficked daily on my border. So we will be the first and only recognized government recognized safe home on our border to take in the kids. I mean, the governor, it was a secret meeting. He came to us asking us to help. They know we love Jesus. They know we believe in Jesus. They know we evangelize. They know everything we are. We don't, and it's a Buddhist nation. Do you understand this? And this is part of the promise. You know, God gives us a promise, and sometimes it's like this, and we see it, you know, at face value, but then it's so much more than what it is. And he had always spoken to me in the dark nations, in the Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu nations, that you will reach a nation through through a generation. You'll change a generation like what you saw. And so I thought that's what it was. But then he started impressing to me his social welfare systems, that you will go into these dark nations where it's looking like it's scary, that no missionaries can go into, that are closed nations, closed, dark, dangerous nations, and you will set up social welfare systems, and you will reach the children of that nation, and they will know Jesus. And that's the way that Jesus will get into the dark nations of the earth, is through the children. And so it's happening right now. We're about halfway through. We'll be done probably around February, and we will be a government-recognized safe home on the border, and everybody, chief of police, governor, everybody will call us for all of the trafficked and beggar children on our border, in our whole region. Is that not crazy and incredible? That's the days that we are living in, when governments come to you and ask you for help. Those are the days that we are living in, where your light shines. The Lord had been speaking to me about what we're building and had me studying on building the temple and the tabernacle. And that's not really, you know, my vein. Your pastor is one of the most incredible teachers on this planet. We actually watch him in our living room, the missionaries. We're with you. We join with you. And he's one of the pastors that we watch and have a home church, home fellowship with. And so I don't get into that, but the Lord has been just working on my heart about building something in my generation. I'm going to share that with you in Chronicles today, but building something in my generation unto him, that they may know that there is no other God besides him, that they may know that there is no other God besides him. And I just saw that and been studying that, to where the Queen of Sheba came when the temple was built, and she did not believe in God, but when she saw how everything was beautiful and magnificent and put in place, then she saw, and she said, bless the Lord your God. And so she knew that there was a God. And the Lord had been speaking to me. He said, what's your building, the mothership that you're building in Thailand? It will be known around the area, around the region, and people will come in Buddhist, 95% Buddhist nations, 99% Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu nations, and they will come and they will know the name of Jesus, and it'll be a lighthouse right there for Southeast Asia. What you are building is something magnificent unto me and my namesake, that it will be a monument in your generation, that people may know him from the rising to the setting, that there is no other God besides him. And so that's what he's doing in Southeast Asia. I want to show you the reason why it's so super huge is, you can go to the next one, the next slide. So this is what's going on, why we're building it and what we're building. In my area, I'm Thailand-Burma border, right? Well, there's a thing called ASEAN that's happening, and it's kind of like the European Union when the EU came together. Well, this is where all the Southeast Asian countries are coming together, all the way up from China, India, Bangladesh, all the way down to Singapore. And it's going to be the new Silk Road, and they're joining together, and it's called ASEAN, and Southeast Asia Union together. And our land that we got about 3.5 years ago, 25 acres, I don't know if you guys heard that story, how we got land at a time where we didn't even have money to buy rice. And God said, I did it all while you were sleeping. You go the next slide. And so in that, right, that's our land. That road that you saw, that red that you saw, is at the top corner right here. Our land is strategically placed on the new Silk Road of Asia. So we're going to be able to reach all the way up to China and all the way down to Singapore and every single country in between in Southeast Asia. It is huge. It is huge what's going on. And you guys are part of it, from Norris City, Illinois. I'm telling you, you're part of it. And another huge thing in that is, because the government has come to us at this time, it's all just the timing of God. We're going to have protection so that we can have our own rescue task force on this Silk Road. There's going to be a lot of drug trafficking all the way up from China, and a lot of child trafficking. And we're going to have our own rescue task force, our own like community rescue task force, right on this road. And so we'll be able to intervene and intercept, and we'll have the protection and the seal of the government, which is super incredible. So it's not just going to be Thailand and Burma, but we're going to rescue all the way up to China and all the way down to Singapore from our border. Is that not crazy and incredible? But another thing that's going on, it's not just rescuing children, because it's never just been about rescuing children. It's about, I'm an evangelist by just my heart. And that was the thing I told the Lord. I said, I'm not a babysitter. You know, I don't want to babysit my 10 children. And Jesus come back and me going to, you know, heaven with my 10 children, just run an orphanage. He told me, I said, I want to win hundreds, thousands, millions to you, Lord. And he said, you will reach more through these children than you could ever reach alone. And so he said, from that, in the children, that they would be going back into their nations and preaching the gospel and bringing Jesus back to their nations. And I would change a nation through a generation. And so from that promise, a lot of my kids from our first homes are on staff with us right now. They're our interpreters. They're on staff with us. But then also, my new generation of kids, they're having visions. I had one girl that had a vision, and she said, a dream. And she said and you have to understand, these kids don't have ID cards. They're illegal. They're trafficked from Burma, so they don't have citizenship. And so she said, I had a dream. And in this dream, I saw a card, an ID card, and it had my picture. And on the top, it said Asian. And she said, and then I looked up, and I saw stairs. And they went into an airplane. And she goes, so I followed the stairs into the airplane. And she said the airplane, it didn't fly that far. It wasn't so long. But then I got down, and when I got out, she said the people's skin were a little bit darker than mine. She said, and it was like a sea of people. And she said a lot of the people went to one side. The people divided into two groups. A lot of the people went to one side, and some people went to this side. And she said, and on the above the people that went to the group, it said those who don't know me. And she said, and the other sign said those who do know me. And she said, and so I got off the airplane, and I walked to the side that says those who don't know me in that group of people. She said, could this be Jesus is calling me to be a missionary to Malaysia? Is this, and my kids speak 3 to 4 languages. And she said, can Jesus be calling me to be a missionary to the Muslims in Malaysia? And then I had, and she's only 14 years old, have another little girl that's 14, 15. She said she was swinging on a swing with Jesus, said that she saw this picture. She's swinging on a swing with Jesus. And then all of a sudden Jesus appeared next to her, and they were swinging together. And Jesus turned over to her and took her heart out of her chest. And then she saw a map on the wall, and he started putting her heart in all the different Southeast Asian nations. And she said, can Jesus be calling me to be a missionary to Southeast Asia? Is that what I'm supposed to do? You have to understand, these kids, they come from the trash. They have no ID. We give them their birth date. We give them their name. They don't even know their age when they come. They know 4 different languages, and God's calling them to be missionaries in that whole region that we're going to reach. It's just incredible what is going on right now. I want to share with you one last thing. If you could go to the circle where they're all praying. Yeah, there you go. Another really cool thing that had just recently happened with all of this. So on our 25 acres, we're building family-style safe homes, and you guys are a part of that. And in that, we were breaking ground on this family-style safe home. And as soon as we were, the guy in the blue, Ryan, he oversees our building and land projects. And he said, Father, we build these homes. We dedicate them in your name for the children that are coming to us. And the children that you are sending, the hundreds of children that you are sending to us. And right then we heard an ironwood gate open. It's the one that Randy Short built actually for us. We hear it start to open, and all of that little boy right there in the blue, his head popped in like that. And we looked, and that's the exact day, that's the exact time. And he told us, I'm hungry and I need clothes, you know. And so he came in. I said, okay, well, we're praying, so you're going to pray with us, and then we'll feed you, you know. So they came straight, and we finished our prayer. Find out the little boy's mom died a year ago. They were living in a little shack right there. There was some abuse, different cases. The father's an alcoholic buffalo herder around that area. And we just did our intervention, how we usually do, and rescued these boys. And actually, that's their home that we're building right there. It is incredible what God is doing so quickly on the earth. Turn over to, I want to go, you know, we're going to go somewhere different. I hope that's okay for the media team. But I have this on my heart that I want to get out for this service. 1 Chronicles 22:5. And you guys should, media team should have it. But we're going to do something different. Can we do something different than the first service? Can we just follow the Lord? 1 Chronicles 22:5. I hope you guys see and understand the impact. You're literally saving lives and building the kingdom of God halfway around the earth. You know, last time I was here, the Lord showed me a picture of Norris City, Illinois, and Crossroads Church, and I saw like Crossroads being a hub, and I saw planes coming and going, and I saw like a picture like you would in an airline with the main hub dot, and then all the different areas that Crossroads would go and reach and impact and be a part of. And I just want you to know, you are, and this is what the Lord had said, you guys will be nationally and internationally known for the works that you guys are about all the way around the world. And so your pastor's vision is huge, and you are a part of it. Nationally and internationally known for what you do around the earth. I want you to know that. A great man said before that the church that shines the farthest shines the brightest at home. And you guys have grown like 150 or 200 since the last time I was here, maybe even 300. I'm sorry, 300 the last time I was here. It's incredible what God's doing in your church and in you guys. And we are just so honored to be a part of it and so very thankful that he's connected us with you guys. Okay, first Chronicles, let's get to the word. 22:5. Now David said, I want to go to my time, okay. Now David said, Solomon, my son, is young and inexperienced, and the house to be built for the Lord must be exceedingly magnificent, famous, and glorious throughout all countries. I will now make preparation for it. So David made abundant preparations before his death. You have to remember that David was the one who wrote, you know, that he had such a heart in the Psalms. He'd always talk about the house and the house of God and his love for the house of God. And you see here that was translated to his son, that was passed down to his son. And this is what's in my heart, that there needs to be a legacy left in our generation, in our day, in our age. It says, and David said to Solomon, my son, as for me, it was in my mind to build a house to the name of the Lord my God. But the word of the Lord came to me saying, you have shed much blood and have made great wars. You shall not build a house for my name because you have shed much blood on the earth and in my sight. Behold, a son shall be born to you, who shall be a man of rest, and I will give him rest from all his enemies all around. His name shall be Solomon, for I will give peace and quietness to Israel in his days. He shall build a house for my name, and he shall be my son, and I will be his father, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom over Israel forever. Now, my son, may the Lord be with you, and may you prosper and build the house of the Lord your God, as he has said to you. Only may the Lord give you wisdom and understanding and give you charge concerning Israel, that you may keep the law of the Lord your God. Then you will prosper if you take care to fulfill the statutes and judgments with which the Lord charged Moses concerning Israel. Look at this. Be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be dismayed. Indeed, I have taken much trouble to prepare for the house of the Lord 100,000 talents of gold, 1,000,000 talents of silver and bronze and iron beyond measure. For it is so abundant. I have prepared timber and stone also, and you may add to them. Moreover, there are workmen with you in abundance, woodsmen and stone cutters and all types of skillful men for every kind of work. Of gold and silver and bronze and iron, there is no limit. Look at this. Arise, arise and begin working, and the Lord be with you. David also commanded all the leaders of Israel to help Solomon his son, saying, is not the Lord your God with you? And has he not given you rest on every side? For he has given the inhabitants of the land into my hand, and the land is subdued before the Lord and before his people. Now set your heart and your soul to seek the Lord your God. Therefore arise and build the sanctuary of the Lord God, to bring the ark of the covenant of the Lord and the holy articles of God into the house that is to be built for the name of the Lord. Stand up with me, please. The reason why with this, I just want you to see in our generation, I feel like there's a charge. It says he charged him. And that word charge means commanded and challenged. And I feel like in our generation, in our hour, in these last days, there's a challenge and there's a command and there's a charge that rings out to the body of Christ. What are we going to build? What are we going to build on this earth for the kingdom of God? Our hands need to be about our Father's business, our Father God. See, what was in David's heart translated to his son. And older men and women, there's a legacy that you need to leave for the body of Christ. There's a legacy and a heart for his house and a heart for his kingdom and a heart for his purposes on the earth. Do you know that David went ahead and passed away, and Solomon because that heart was passed. And young people, I'm telling you, that's all that we need to do in this lifetime is build something with our hands, a monument unto the Lord our God, to build his house, to be about his purposes, this house, to build his kingdom. To build his kingdom, the lost, the saved, it's all generations. Do you guys see this? It's all generations. It's for you and it's for me. What are we going to build? What are we going to leave behind? David left behind such a love for God's house, such a love for the kingdom, such a love that it translated to his son. And his son was about his father's business. And that's what the father is saying today. Can his heart be your heart? Can his heart, will it translate to you? Will your generation that challenged that command, just that charge of build something unto the Lord, build his kingdom, let your hands be about it. I love this. The Lord has spoken to me about this, about being young and inexperienced, but yet my hands want to build for the kingdom of God on this earth. And that's all that matters, is what my hands are about for the kingdom of God. I believe the same for you, for your generation, for this day, for this hour. I believe it, and I believe that you'll be brave and strong. And it says, arise and begin to work. Rise out of our fears, rise out of our insecurity, rise out of our personalities, rise out of our personal limitations, rise out of what we think we can or cannot do, rise out of these things. I would have never thought that we're going to set up social welfare systems in third world nations to bring the gospel to the lost. I would have never thought of that. But if I would have let things held me back, my own personalities, my own fear, different things, we would have never done these things. So I say to you, God wants to use you to do the exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask, think, or imagine. Lift your hands. I want to pray for you. If you see this, you're not too old to be used for the kingdom of God, to leave a legacy with a heart for his house and a heart for his kingdom. And you're not too young or inexperienced to do something unto the Lord your God. This has to be the purpose. This has to be the mission. It was David's dream, but it was Solomon's mission. And God's dream for mankind and God's heart for mankind needs to be our mission. It needs to be our challenge. It needs to be our command. It needs to be our charge. We've given you charging orders this morning to arise and build. Build this house. Build this vision. Build the kingdom of God in this day, in this age, in this generation, in this hour. Let me pray for you. Father, use these hands. You see these hands all around the room. Use these hands to build your kingdom. Use these hands to bring the gospel, to bring your kingdom to this earth. Use these hands, Father. Use these hands in this generation to bring your purposes and your heart to mankind. During right now, right where they're at in their sphere of influence, use their hands, Father God. Use their hands to heal. Use their hands to save. Use their hands to set free. Use their hands to build. Father God, use their hands just to serve your kingdom. Use their hands. We just commit our hands to your purposes and your will. We commit our hands to good and not evil. We commit our hands to good and to not to do evil, Father, for your purposes, your plans, and your will. We thank you for it, and we will build you something in our generation. We will build a monument into your name, that the Queen of Sheba, that everyone around us will come and see that there is none other besides our God. There is no other God. There is no other one that saves, that heals, delivers. There's no other answer besides our God. There is none other from the rising of the sun to its setting. There is none other besides our God. Thank you, Father. Look at your hands. God wants to use your hand. God wants to use your hand. In the first service, I shared Acts 3, and you can read it when you get home, and you see it's God's power, it's God's spirit, it's everything that God is, but he needs your hand to build it. He needs your hand. He has chosen to use your hand to bring it to the earth in this generation and in this hour. Will you give him your hand? Will you let your hand be about his heart and his purposes and not our own? Amen. I love you guys. Thank you for having us.
Come on, give God some praise. Thank you, Lana. Guys, it's God speaking to you specifically about your hand and what you're supposed to do. I was out of it, asleep, and I woke up this morning, and I looked at the clock and it was 1:11 in the morning. And I'm like, first thought is, of course, it's 1:11 in the morning. But then I said, you know, okay, I've learned to kind of ask. I said, Lord, is there anything you're wanting to say? And I was hoping not. But he said, Romans 1:11. And here's what it says. This is God speaking to you. He says, for I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, so that you may be established. That is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Here's what God's saying to you. I long to see you. I long to see you. Why does he wake me up at 1:11? Because he longs to see me. He longs to see you. Why? Not just so he can wake you up and cause you to sleep, because he wants to impart something in you that mutually you and God together can change the world. Now, I'm not talking about we all got to move to Thailand and be missionaries. We just finished our Circles of Influence series where we realize that now your circle of influence, stay in your job, stay in your community, and begin to take Jesus into your region, into your area, into your business, that wherever you're interacting with people, God wants to introduce people to you so you can introduce them to Jesus. He's going to bring people across your path. So we're partnering with him. He's saying, folks, how are we going to reach this region, 19 counties strong? Because he longs to see you, to put your hand to work in your business, in your job, in your school, or in ministry. Some of you specifically will be called to missions work. Receive that call and go with it full throttle. Some of you may be sticking your job, and that is going to be your mission field, is your circle of influence. Stay in there and be excited about what God has called you to do. So I just want us to pray. Father, I just bless you. I thank you for what you're doing. We long to see you move in this region, to move in our nation, to move in this world. God, thank you for the opportunity to partner with you all around the world, that our mutual faith working together can see this world change for the kingdom of Jesus Christ. God, I'm thankful for this body of believers that is dreaming big, that is releasing vision, to realizing that your church, you want it to expand and to reach people, to see people saved and set free. God, I'm thankful for them, and I pray, God, you continue to use them in their jobs, in their businesses, in their schools, in their classrooms, in whatever field, whatever circle of influence. God, I thank you that our government is being influenced by the kingdom of God. Our political system, our education system, our entertainment system, all of it's being influenced by the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for it, God, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.